My name is Leuren Moret. I'm a geoscientist, and I am a specialist in radiation and the impact that it's had globally from nuclear weapons testing, nuclear power plants, and depleted uranium weaponry. I worked at two nuclear weapons laboratories and became a whistleblower in 1991 at the Livermore Nuclear Weapons Lab. I'm a geoscientist, which means that I study the Earth and Earth processes. And this happens to be a very, very good background to understand radiation and how it cycles through the environment. The health of the environment is extremely important for public health because we drink the same water, we breathe the same air, and we eat food from soils that may be contaminated. So we can be no healthier than the health of the environment. And that is why the health of the environment is so important for the future of humanity and for all life. Now, I read about a dentist in the 1930s named Dr. Weston Price. He went all over the world studying indigenous people living on their indigenous diets. And what he discovered is that good health, an absence of cancer, an absence of tooth decay is perfectly normal in indigenous people living on their natural indigenous diets. And also he discovered that the children have disease-free childhoods. I don't think that we could find indigenous people now who are truly as healthy as they were in the 1930s, because our whole global environment has been contaminated from the atomic bomb testing, which was conducted from the 1950s up until 1993, when the Chinese finally stopped. The harm of radiation has always been known since the 1920s. So bureaucratized governments, scientific power, and the military have always known since the 1920s about the terrible harm of ionizing radiation. And this is a book by Dr. Lee. It's called Actions of Radiation on Living Cells. I went to the library to get his paper, which he wrote in the 1920s, on he was experimenting on fruit flies, Drosophila melanogaster, and exposing them to X-rays. And he would expose one male fruit fly at a time to one X-ray, and then he studied the damage, the genetic damage that was proliferated over the next 40,000 generations of that fruit fly. And he could study that because fruit flies have a very, very short life cycle. If you think about how many life cycles humans have had in the last 10,000 years, let's say a person has an average reproductive cycle of every 20 years, that's 5 generations in 100 years, and that would be 500 in 10,000 years. So we're doing an awful lot of damage to future generations without even realizing it. And the terrible truth is that the damage from ionizing radiation to DNA is irreversible. It's permanent damage. There is some natural background radiation from the sun, from cosmic rays, from the solar wind, and from minerals in our environment. But those are very low levels, and we have an ionosphere, which is a layer in the atmosphere that actually protects us from radiation entering into our environment. Not completely, but does a pretty good job. And so our bodies have, or all living things, have evolved over 4.5 billion years, the age of the Earth, to adapt to or to be able to recover from or to survive the natural levels of radiation. And the body has things like protector molecules, which can neutralize the energy from the ionizing radiation in the cells. And there are other things, other factors that help. But what we're doing by exploding thousands of nuclear weapons over a 30-year period is that we're releasing far, far, far more radiation into the atmosphere than our bodies can handle. It's overburdening all living things with this radiation. So, actually, what does radioactive mean? Radioactive means that it's an element, one of the basic units of physical matter that has a nervous nucleus. That's what I call it, a nervous nucleus. And almost every element on the periodic chart can become radioactive under certain conditions. When we put plutonium or uranium into a nuclear bomb and send it up into the atmosphere or underground and detonate it, it explodes. And what happens is all the elements or the atoms of plutonium or uranium, they fragment. In other words, they sort of tear unevenly in half. And that produces all kinds, hundreds of radioactive elements that aren't normally radioactive in the normal situation in the physical world. So these radioactive atoms go all over in the atmosphere, and they are so tiny, the very tiny ones stay suspended in the atmosphere. So what have we done in the United States? The American population is the most nuclear bomb population in the world. We detonated almost 1,200 nuclear weapons in testing at the Nevada test site. And this is the fallout map, which is made from U.S. government data measured on the ground of the man-made radiation, which our government was measuring the whole time. And the reason this is so spotty is because the radiation is not fallout. The fallout falls to the ground quite soon after the explosion, but it depends on the size of the particles. But the very tiny particles, the nanoparticles of radioactive materials, are transported in the air across the United States, and they only end up in the environment and in our bodies and exposing us when they're rained out or snowed out of the atmosphere. So that map represents the combined tests, and as you can see, it went all over the United States. Now, what is very interesting is that a woman, a little old lady in tennis shoes, never underestimate them, named Sally Devlin, lives in Nevada, and she was able to get some documents declassified for me because she's a very, very smart lady. And what she got declassified for me is documents about the secret EPA dairy. The Environmental Protection Agency secretly had a dairy at the Nevada test site, and they were measuring the radiation in the milk, in the cows, in the calves, They even had beef herds there, and they were also measuring the radiation in the beef herds. This is the strontium 90 concentration measured in Nevada right after these bomb tests. So you can see strontium 90, which is almost chemically like calcium, when it's taken up into the body and it ends up in the bones and the teeth and different cell processes. So strontium 90 is a very, very dangerous isotope for living systems. And I think it's very evident from the fallout map and the EPA dairy data that our government was fully aware that they were poisoning the entire population of the United States and beyond, because they were measuring radiation all over the world. This is a paper, Fallout and Reproduction of Ocean Fish Populations, and this is by Dr. Ernest Sternglass. The fishing catch in the North Atlantic declined 50% by 1963 from the beginning of the bomb testing. And when we signed the Partial Test Ban Treaty with Russia in 1963, as you can see, the population rebounded even to more fishing catch, higher catches than before the bomb testing started. And the reason is that when you put a stressor on a biological population, once that stressor is removed, the biological population will over-recover, and then it comes back into balance to the levels that it was originally at if other factors are not influencing it. And the strontium 90, which the Norwegian government measured in the milk, was in Norway, it exactly correlated with that decline in the fishing catch. So there is definitely a correlation between the strontium 90 levels measured in Norway, which would have been coming across the Atlantic and contaminating it, and the decline in the fishing catch. So the radiation not only killed our babies, it killed the babies of other living species too. In the Pacific, the fishing catch declined over 65%, and it never did come back to previous levels because some countries continued nuclear weapons testing. The Chinese didn't stop until 1993. The radioactive fallout from the nuclear weapons tests in Nevada at the Nevada test site actually contaminated also the Sierra Nevada mountains, and when the radioactive cloud from the Chernobyl disaster went around the world, it went over the Sierra Nevada mountains, and it was rained and snowed out, and further contaminated the soils and the water and the environment in the Sierras. Now, what is very interesting is I've worked in the Hunters Point community in San Francisco, which was the Hunters Point Naval Shipyard all through World War II. And after World War II, the Navy wanted to study radiation. You know, they were doing all these bomb tests. So they had a secret radiation laboratory there with 65 naval officers, and there were 550 civilian scientists working there with the naval officers. And even a bomb test expert that I know, Marion Falk, he also worked in the Manhattan Project, did not know. He worked at Livermore for 20 years. He never knew about that secret radiation lab at Hunters Point in San Francisco. And it was just 45 or 50 miles away. So I believe that the Navy knows more about radiation probably than any other agency in the United States. It certainly knows an awful lot. And they also have the nuclear submarines, and they carry most of the nuclear weapons on their ships, both submarines and surface ships. So it seems reasonable to assume that the Navy is very, very knowledgeable about radiation. Now, I worked at the Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory for 5 years, which is above the UC Berkeley campus in the San Francisco Bay Area, and that was in the end of the 1970s. I left in 1981, and then in 1989 I went out to the Livermore Nuclear Weapons Laboratory and worked there for 2 years, and that's where I really started to understand what nuclear weapons are about, although I didn't know anything about radiation then. It was on a trip to Japan in the year of 2000 when I was invited to speak at the plenary session of the Atomic and Hydrogen Bomb Conference in Japan. And that's where I begin to understand the horror of nuclear weapons and the reality of what we're doing to our entire planet. I came back after I had visited the Hiroshima and the Nagasaki Peace Museums. And the Japanese have worked very, very hard for over 50 years to educate the global population about radiation, about nuclear weapons, and about the horror of being the only country bombed in warfare with nuclear weapons. Now, they only were bombed with two bombs. The little boy was the bomb dropped on Hiroshima in 1945 on August the 6th. That was a uranium bomb. And about a few days later, the United States military dropped Fat Man on Nagasaki, and that was a plutonium bomb. So in reality, the Japanese had already lost the war. They'd already offered to surrender. I think they offered to Switzerland to surrender maybe 4 or 5 months before the bombs were dropped on Japan, and they were not allowed to surrender because our nuclear bombs were not ready to be dropped on Japan. In reality, the dropping of the bombs was to experiment with those bombs and to warn Russia not to mess with the United States because we had these horrific weapons. Going back to the San Francisco Bay Area, it's an extremely radioactive environment. It's been polluted from the Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory, activities on the UC Berkeley campus, the Naval Radiological Defense Lab, even Stanford, the SLAC experimental apparatus is exposing the population in the city of Palo Alto who live along the SLAC. It's got a very long accelerator path, and people living at the end of that accelerator are being exposed as well as along it to particles that are spalling out of the accelerator. So we also are being contaminated in the Bay Area. We get almost all of our drinking water out of the Sierra Nevada mountains. And I discovered a couple of years ago a paper in the Journal of Environmental Radioactivity, which was published in 2002. And I suddenly understood why there's so much breast cancer in the Bay Area, particularly Marin County. The Lawrence Livermore Laboratory, where I worked, did a very expensive and a very in-depth study measuring radio cesium in North San Francisco Bay in Baja California coastal surface waters. And what this told me is that the Livermore Laboratory and the University of California, who's been the manager for 61 years, is fully aware of the environmental contamination from their radioactive activities at the Nevada test site and the Livermore Nuclear Weapons Laboratory. And what has happened is that the radiation that was rained out and snowed out into the Sierras, not only from the Nuclear Weapons Laboratory, the Navy Radiological Defense Lab in the Bay Area, San Francisco, but also Chernobyl, and most importantly is that the Rancho Seco Nuclear Power Plant at the foot of the Sierras, right outside of Sacramento, was operating until 1989, and 95% of the radioactive emissions were rained out and snowed out into the Sierras. So the legacy of all of that Cold War activity and the nuclear power plant in Sacramento, it has had a terrible impact on the Bay Area public health. And this is also true around nuclear power plants around the world, nuclear weapons laboratories and facilities around the world. And I'll explain that later with the breast cancer map, which clearly shows the low-level radiation from all of these activities, whether it's nuclear power plants, testing of depleted uranium weapons, or nuclear weapons facilities. It is having a devastating effect on public health, not only in the United States, but globally. Why do we have nuclear weapons? Nuclear weapons basically are being used as nuclear blackmail. And if you look at this very important book, The Naked Nuclear Emperor, by Commander Robert Greene, a British Navy commander who was in charge of all the nuclear submarines, and at some point he had a moment of conscience and he came to his senses and has now gone around the world speaking and writing against nuclear weapons because it's so horrific. We can't use them without contaminating the whole planet. This map in his book is very, very telling, and this shows the nuclear states in the Northern Hemisphere and the fact very clearly that the Southern Hemisphere is a nuclear-free weapon zone. The nuclear weapons program has allowed us to have a very, very large economy and to acquire tremendous wealth in our country. But that nuclear weapons program and all of that Cold War activity developing these horrific weapons did not come at a low price. And this is the executive summary of the Department of Energy, March 1995, when the Department of Energy under Hazel O'Leary, who was very, very good at bringing transparency to the Department of Energy, she released the estimate of the Cold War mortgage. Well, my goodness, we have 10,500 sites and locations in the United States that are contaminated with radiation, because in reality, Edward Teller, who was the director for a short period at the Livermore Nuclear Weapons Laboratory and who sold Star Wars to President Reagan in 1 hour, he was crazy about nuclear weapons, and in fact, people around the world gave him the name Dr. Strangelove because people who like big bombs that kill lots of people are strange people. And so the Cold War mortgage, actually, he turned the whole United States into a nuclear weapons factory. And they will never, ever, ever clean up the nuclear legacy. They're trying in some areas, some locations, but some areas like the Nevada test site, the Jefferson Proving Ground, the Clinch River, some areas are the Hanford area in Washington State. These are national sacrifice zones because they'll never be cleaned up. It would be impossible to clean them up. And just the Jefferson Proving Ground, I think the estimate to clean it up now in 2005 is over $7 billion. They're not going to do it. It's not a good return on their investment, so it won't happen. So I think people would say, or might think, how do you know so much about radiation, and how in the world did your career end up in such a different field? And I really thought I was going to be a mother and stay home and cook and sew and have family events, and I really expected to have a totally normal life. But once you go and work in a nuclear weapons laboratory, it's like joining the mafia. You can never get out of the mafia. You let go of them, but they will never let go of you. And I just learned the hard way that radiation is forever. And I didn't know anything about radiation. I'm a geologist, a geoscientist. And what geoscientists use radiation for is to date rocks. And so we'll measure the radioactive isotopes in rocks or minerals in rocks. And then we can determine the date of how old, the age of the rocks or the formation or the mountain range or whatever. So that's about all I knew about radiation. And then I went and worked in two nuclear weapons laboratories. At the Lawrence Berkeley lab, I worked on studying volcanoes and magmas and how the magma chamber creates the magma, and then when the volcano erupts, what happens to it, and the ash and dust that go all over the world. That helped me to understand how nuclear weapons fallout and rainout can go all the way around the world, because it becomes a component of atmospheric dust. And millions of tons of atmospheric dust are transported all around the world every year. And the dust has a lot of hitchhikers. It has bacteria, it has fungus, it has viruses, and of course it has radioactive isotopes. So that was really, really interesting to me. I love atmospheric dust. After I worked at the Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory, I wanted to travel. And I went around the world on different trips. I've been in about 44 countries now. And I just thought life was just a big adventure. And then I came back and I had a daughter named Zephyr. And I ended up going to Livermore, to move to Livermore to be able to have a job and to support her. And that was in 1989 that I started working at the Livermore Nuclear Weapons Laboratory. I was working on the Yucca Mountain Project, which is the most important public works project in the history of the United States, because it is a project which has been ongoing for over 50 years to find a place, a suitable repository, to store the nuclear waste from the nuclear weapons program, the nuclear power plants, and the tremendous amount of depleted uranium, which is the radioactive trash from those programs. And even though they've spent over $3 billion in ratepayers' money, they were taxed in order to build this repository, the Department of Energy and the U.S. government has been unable to build a repository. I became a whistleblower in 1991 on the Yucca Mountain Project and the Superfund Project at Livermore, which I was also working on. And I became completely disillusioned with science in the United States because I discovered in those 2 years at Livermore that most of the science in the United States is basically science fraud, and that most scientists are prostitutes for the military or corporations. And I remember standing in my laboratory in 1991 and looking out the window, and I just said, I don't want to be a prostitute for the military or corporations. And I packed everything in my car, drove out the gate, dropped off my badge and my beeper, and I said, I'm out of jail. Oh, this feels wonderful. And little did I know that when you step over that line, it's an invisible line, and you go against the nuclear weapons program or the nuclear power program, you get tangled up in the politics of radiation. And I was completely, absolutely devastated by retaliation, whistleblower retaliation, by the University of California and the Livermore Lab. And they bankrupted me. They broke into my house, into my car. They put pornographic website charges on my credit cards. They kidnapped my daughter when she was 13. I didn't see her until she was 18. And I really did have the Karen Silkwood experience where they try to run you off the road. They do everything you can imagine to intimidate and frighten you. And all I can say is that when the going gets tough, the tough get going. And I learned to be much, much stronger. It was actually a gift more than a disaster. I learned a tremendous amount just surviving that experience. And I'm really very lucky to be alive. So I was invited in 2000 to the Hiroshima and Nagasaki Atomic and Hydrogen Bomb Conference, and in those two museums, seeing the truth about nuclear weapons really changed my life. And in the Hiroshima Museum, there are dioramas with the people with their skin dripping from them, and oh God, the shadows of people on the stone walls. They brought the stone walls and the steps where people were sitting when they were vaporized. And there's just a shadow. It's like somebody was vaporized there. It was astounding to see that. And I was okay until I was standing under the model of Little Boy, the bomb they dropped on Hiroshima. And because I was a nuclear weapons laboratory whistleblower, the media, I had all these movie cameras in my face and did so many television interviews and newspaper interviews. It was astounding. And I looked up and I saw Little Boy, and I felt so terrible because I knew that scientists had made that possible through the misapplication of science. It's really engineers who made the bomb, engineered the bomb. But I knew that scientists like me had made that horrific weapon possible. And I started to cry, and I could not stop sobbing all the way through the museum. And then we had to sit and have a press conference with 15 journalists and TV cameras, and it just took me half an hour to stop sobbing. I just was overwhelmed. And then we went to Nagasaki, and again in that museum, it was the photograph of a young Japanese mother just an hour after the bomb had been dropped on Nagasaki, and her kimono was open. She was bare-breasted, nursing her dying baby, and her hair was all blown into a mess, and the pattern of her kimono was burned into her skin from the gamma rays and the fast neutrons. And that was another moment that helped me to decide that I would spend the rest of my life working on radiation issues. And I just said, oh my God, that young mother could be me, and that baby could be my baby. And so, because I'm a mother and because I'm a scientist, I decided that the best thing I could do with my life is to work on radiation issues around the world and to inform people about these horrific weapons, about the low-level radiation, and what we must do to stop this nuclear nightmare. I have two mentors who have helped me and educated me and mentored me. One is Marion Falk, who lives in Livermore. He was a scientist on the Manhattan Project at the University of Chicago. And later he ended up at Livermore working on the nuclear weapons program. And he has spent the last 5 years teaching me everything about radioactive fallout and rainout, especially the very, very fine particles that remain suspended and travel around the world. And without his persistence and his care and his patience, I would not be able to be talking about all of this today. And I just love him, and I've never had such a wonderful man in my life. And he, going to see him is like sitting under a tree for the day with Plato. He's just so wonderful, and he talks about the radiation and more about the philosophy of it. He shows me where the information is. He shows me how to use it. And then he goes over everything that I write very, very carefully so that I don't make any mistakes. The other person who's helped me is, this is Ernest Sternglass, Dr. Ernest Sternglass. And Dr. Sternglass has worked on radiation issues since the 1950s. He's an engineer and a physicist. And Dr. Sternglass is the scientist who President Kennedy asked to testify in Congress about the link between radioactive fallout and children's cancer and illnesses. And Dr. Sternglass convinced the Senate to sign the Partial Test Ban Treaty, which they did in 1963. And what Sternglass talked about was the horrific increases in infant mortality. Millions of unborn babies and newborns were actually killed in the United States from the atmospheric testing up until 1963. And he discovered many other things. This is his paper, which President Kennedy saw and is the reason why President Kennedy asked him to testify in Congress. The title of the paper is Cancer: Relation of Prenatal Radiation to Development of the Disease in Childhood. He also wrote another paper, Epidemiological Studies of Fallout in Patterns of Cancer Mortality. And some of this is actually about the Japanese. He also wrote a very, very important paper. It's called Fallout and SAT Scores, Evidence for Cognitive Damage During Early Infancy. So what he discovered and proved with government data, again, we always use government data, because how can they challenge their own data? They just don't use it the way we use it. We use it to tell the truth. They use it to hide the truth. This is the decline in SAT scores for the entire young population in the United States. So the year that they were born is the year that children were exposed in utero as fetuses to ionizing radiation, which came through the mother's diet and the mother's drinking water into the body of the fetus. We have collected baby teeth from children living around nuclear power plants. We've collected over 6,000 and measured the strontium-90 in them. And this, our study, was based on a study by Dr. Barry Commoner at Washington University in St. Louis, who collected almost 350,000 baby teeth during atmospheric testing. That wonderful, wonderful man batch tested them. The instruments were not sensitive enough to measure the radiation in just one little tiny baby tooth. So he would put them in batches and they measured the radiation and discovered a whole generations of children have terrible levels, who were born in those years have terrible levels of strontium-90 in their baby teeth. And what Dr. Sternglass was able to show is that the SAT scores for all children in the United States born between 1940 to 1965, that the pre-bomb testing scores were about 475, and by 1963, the children born that year, their SAT scores had dropped to 420 or 425, which is a tremendous decline. That's 50 points. That's 10%. That's a huge decline. And what he discovered is that the scores did not recover fully afterwards. So we know now today that the long-term effects of internal radiation exposure, particularly to fetuses, is permanent and it's passed on to their children. He also showed that the kilotonnage of the bombs, that's how big the bombs were, correlated with the decline in the SAT scores. And also children living in states closer to the bomb testing area at the Nevada test site were more impacted than children living at greater distances. Now, there was also brain damage done to the whole U.S. population. And in a journal of the American Medical Association, a study, June 2nd, 2004, which was published in the Journal of the American Medical Association Journal, it's a study by the World Health Organization, and it's actually a survey of global mental health in not just the United States, but other countries. So what they did was they measured the percentage of the population in different countries around the world and compared the percentage in each country with some form of mental illness. And in Shanghai, 4.3% of the population has some form of mental illness. In Japan, it's 8.8%. In the Ukraine, which is where the Chernobyl disaster happened, 20.4% of the population has some form of mental illness. In France, where they are 75% reliant on nuclear energy, and they have several nuclear reprocessing plants, 18.4% of the population has some form of mental illness. In Mexico, it's 12.2%, and in the United States, it's over 26.3%. The United States has the highest rate of mental illness in the world. Other diseases that are mysteriously increasing many times in a very short period of time, autism would be an example of a disease that no one can explain why it's happening. Autism has increased six times since the early 1990s without a reasonable explanation. When we got State of California data for autism in the state of California, this is their official report, we found that there was almost no autism in the state of California until bomb testing started. And you can see the increase here. But it went up exponentially at the end of from the 1990s until now. And when we used Nuclear Regulatory Commission data on the number of kilowatt hours of nuclear energy produced each year in the state of California, you can see this exponential increase. They exactly correlate. They coincide, and there's definitely a problem with nuclear power plants in the United States and how they're impacting future generations. We also confirmed this same pattern nationwide using other government data. So it's pretty clear that low-level radiation from nuclear power plants is certainly a cofactor in the huge increases in autism in the United States. When we looked at United States government data on hypothyroidism in newborns, we found that the very, very large increases in hypothyroidism in newborns correlated very, very strongly with the amount of nuclear energy generated in the United States for all of the nuclear power plants in the U.S. So here are two different studies which really do prove that nuclear power plants are not good for our babies. And I can confidently say that this is the major contributing factor, the bomb testing in the United States. In fact, the United States population is the most nuclear bomb population in the world. And the long-term effects will only be revealed in future years. We already know that it's really, really bad. For instance, the epidemic of cancer, epidemic of diabetes, the epidemic of Alzheimer's and MS, and neuromuscular and neurological diseases. These are all damage to not only the fetuses and the babies, but also to adults. In a recent study on dental radiography, this is from also the Journal of the American Medical Association in April of 2004, they did studies on children that were born after mothers had had dental x-rays during their pregnancy. And they were able to show that the babies are brain damaged. Even though the mother has a lead apron covering her body, damage to the thyroid upsets and disturbs the hormones and signaling mechanism to signal the baby's brain development. So truly, there are no safe levels of radiation. And I want to emphasize that, because people think that using radiation for medical diagnostics is okay. It's not okay. There's always damage and there's always a risk, increased risk. So these medical technologies using ionizing radiation should only be used if it's really very, very serious and very necessary. I want to show this book, Low-Level Radiation and Immune System Damage, an Atomic Era Legacy. This is by Joseph Mangano, an epidemiologist I work with, and with Dr. Sternglass. We're a group of independent scientists who, of course, I mentioned we're doing the baby teeth study, but we're interested in the long-term effects of radiation exposure, particularly to fetuses and children, because the fetus is the most susceptible to the greatest damage of all ages. And when a sperm or an egg is damaged, the DNA is damaged, in the developing fetus, every cell in that fetus that forms a young person has that genetic damage in it. When adults are exposed to radiation, it may kill some of the local cells. That's called the somatic effect, and they can survive that. But what happens in the uterus determines the health history of that young person for the rest of their lives. Now, why is ionizing radiation so bad? This is a particle of plutonium, and these toothpicks represent the alpha particles, or the radioactive particles that are ejected from the nucleus. This just represents a couple of days in a 1/10 micron particle. This is actually a photograph of a plutonium particle in the lung tissue of an ape. This photo was taken at the Lawrence Livermore lab where I worked. These tiny, tiny particles, a 1/10 of a micron particle, is 100 times smaller than a white blood cell. And so when these get into the body and they're transported in the blood, and they may be carried in the lipids or the cholesterol right through the cell wall into the interior of the cell, these radioactive particles are releasing huge amounts of energy, and so it's like nuking a cell, and it also destroys the signaling mechanism or disturbs it where the cells signal to each other. We're a complex animal or organism, and our cells have to signal to each other, and they have to be coordinated in the processes that make life possible. And so when these huge amounts of energy, for instance, the molecules of life in a cell are held together, the binding energy is less than 10 electron volts. One alpha particle releases 4.2 million electron volts in I can just say, let's say uranium-238, which is what the depleted uranium weapons and bombs are made out of that the U.S. has been using since 1991. So if one of these alpha particles releases 4.2 million electron volts, what in the world happens in the parts of the cells where you have plutonium or any other radioactive isotopes lodged? They slowly destroy the body and life and cause all kinds of diseases. This is a new report from 2003 by the European Committee on Radiation Risk. And this is about 45 independent scientists who wrote this report for the European Parliament on low-level radiation. And this completely challenges the A-bomb studies that the United States did after Hiroshima and Nagasaki. So basically, this study by these scientists, based on over 550 scientific papers, proves that all of the standards for radiation exposure, which the International Committee on Radiation Protection has been using, are irrelevant, because the A-bombs were external exposure to the fast neutrons and the gamma rays, and they only considered that two diseases were caused by radiation exposure. That was cancer and birth defects. And what we know now from all the studies that have been happening since then, since World War II, and many done after Chernobyl, that really taught us a lot about radiation exposure and the effects, and also better instrumentation. For instance, now we can measure the radiation in one baby tooth instead of a batch. So all of these studies on different kinds of exposures have given us a whole body of scientific data and information that makes it very, very clear that the A-bomb studies, that model for determining risk and dose response, is very underestimated. And this study shows that the risk is actually as much as 1,000 times more harmful than what the A-bomb studies produced.